So welcome to the season 15 commentary. Usually we do our commentary right after we're done doing the shows, which would have been a couple of months ago in November. Right now it's January 2012. And I don't know about you, Trey, but I was all the holidays. I was just looking forward to this.
Yeah, these commentaries. I couldn't wait to come do this.
It was weird to not have done it, and just I've just been aching to do it. So this was Human Centipede, which also was the subject of the 6 Days of South Park documentary that our friend Arthur Bradford did that people might have seen on Comedy Central. This was the show that we were in production on that was in that documentary.
Yeah, and this whole season was the season we did basically right after the Book of Mormon opened, so we kind of went through this crazy few months of opening Book of Mormon and being there in New York and doing all that, and then we had a couple weeks off and came and did South Park. And so on the one hand, we were kind of like freaked out we might be too frazzled. But on the other hand, our brains were kind of working well. So I actually remember this half of the run being like not terrible.
Yeah.
Actually like the ideas came pretty quick because I think we were just still, our brains had been worked out.
And this one came from, I think Trey, you talked about like just signing, you know, having to log on and wanting to buy some iTunes or something, having to click okay and agree for the 800th time to the iTunes thing, because they update it like 5 times a year or whatever.
Yeah, it was literally the night every time you use it. Before our writers meeting that night before, I just had to update iTunes. You know, you always have to update iTunes, and it's so frustrating sometimes.
And then it's not that much better.
Yeah, and you're just always clicking on agree, 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 and then I just kind of thought, like, I wonder what I'm agreeing. Like, nobody ever reads that whole thing. You always just scroll to the bottom so that agree highlights and you can click on it. But so then the whole thing came on, and like, what if you're agreeing to something really messed up? And it came, of course, from seeing the Human Centipede movie.
I don't know who said Human Centipede, because I don't know. Whenever somebody said that, we were all
pretty
proud of ourselves.
Well, I think we were talking about making fun of it. We were talking about doing a parody of Human Centipede, and then I think that you know, it's like, well, what if you're agreeing to something really messed up, like being, you know, ass to mouth? And then I think Human Centipede came right out. And then you know you have a show.
Basically. Once you say Human Centipede, you're like, well, we've just got to go do that.
And this was like, what, like 6-7 months before Steve Jobs died?
Yeah, and we sort of thought about that. That sort of sucked.
Yeah, because he was on a downward spiral.
Well, he's been sick for a long time, but we kind of made him just like what it sounds like he sort of is if you read the book about him, which is he was a hard worker, and like he drove people. He just was like a perfectionist, you know, so we kind of made him like that in this episode. He's a little bit mean, but he was apparently pretty mean in real life.
We were just worried he was going to die the day this aired or something, or like the day before, and then we're going to look really mean. But I remember that
there were a lot of people too. I remember a lot of people from this episode that were like, holy shit, that's the grossest thing I've ever seen. And they didn't know about Human Centipede.
Yeah, we're like, dude, I didn't think of that.
I had people ask me that because, you know, because Human Centipede wasn't the biggest movie in the world, you know, right. But once you know that, once you know it, you don't ever really.
No, I remember like, it was like almost a year before this that Vernon, one of our writers, was like, have you seen the trailer for this movie, Human Centipede? And he told us what it's about, we're like, and we're like, no, shut up. That's like, obviously
this is real.
Like, and then we finally saw the trailer, like, no way is someone actually making this movie. So it took us. And then I think it was like, yeah, several, after it had come to the theaters, and then I finally got the DVD of it, and it was just like, the anticipation of how bad it was going to be, like, was way worse than what it actually was. Like, when you're watching it, you're just kind of like, well, this is dumb. And you can't believe that there's, if you watch Human Centipede and then imagine that there's a crew around them and like a guy with a boom thing and someone there was a script supervisor and like these people ass to mouth and diapers, you're like, didn't anyone at some point go, you know what, guy, let's not do this. This is like kind of fucked up.
Nope. Luckily they didn't.
Yeah. All right, well, let's move on to Funny Bot. That's probably all we have to say about
it. Eric, we can't afford that one.
This is our episode called Funny Bot, and we had the idea for Funny Bot. It was one of these ideas that was just like in every season for like 4 or 5 years.
We've been talking about Funny Bot for at least 5 years.
Just like a big funny robot, and the original idea of it was going to be that Jimmy got invited to this big stand-up comedy festival in Japan, and that it turns out all the Japanese were just inviting people there because they were going to put it up against their Funny Bot, and Funny Bot was this like giant robot like the size of a skyscraper that ended up destroying Tokyo. And for some reason, I mean, it was just,
we had a whole Enter the Dragon thing too. That's how they compete. I don't know why we didn't do
it. We never could come around to the idea, and then we finally decided this season, we're like, well, what if Funny Bot isn't in Japan, it's like at South Park, and it's just like normal human size, and we decided to base it more off of an episode of Star Trek called The Changeling with Nomad.
Pretty soon we're going to get through all the episodes of Star Trek. Yeah. We're not going to be able to parody anymore.
We're slowly doing it.
We're like about 15 in.
Yeah. But it was also because we basically got invited to go to the Comedy Central Comedy Awards. And Matt and I got this invitation saying, congratulations, you've been nominated for a comedy award by Comedy Central. And we're like, well, we better. But
on the other hand, like, we don't want to be.
Yeah. Like,
it's like when... What was it? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was like us and Family Guy and like...
Yeah, but it was also like your mom is the teacher and you're nominated for Student of the Week. You're like, Mom, you can't give me Student of the Week.
Yeah. So they're like, but they begged us. And we were in New York doing Book of Mormon. And they're like, you got to come to the Comedy Awards. And we like didn't want it because, you know, you look stupid going up there and like and accepting an award from your own network. Like, on the one hand, like if we win, then it's like we look like douchebags. And if you lose, you really look like douchebags. So it's like, but they kind of talked us into it and begged us to go and thought it was going to become this big thing. And then we were sitting there at the Comedy Awards talking about how stupid the whole idea of a comedy award was.
Right.
And then we decided to make a whole South Park episode about it, about Jimmy putting on comedy awards and nobody came. And then that's when we're like, oh, we could finally use that funny bot idea if it's finally, you know, a funny robot that ends up being the funniest. And it was also one of those times where I believe it was on Sunday of making this episode that the announcement came out that they had shot Osama bin Laden.
Mm-hmm. And I was in the office. I remember I was walking Eric Stahl's office and he had it on TV. That's right.
Yeah. And we already had the thing in where... didn't we already have the thing where... We already had all the Tyler Perry stuff in, for sure.
Yeah, that was already...
And so I think that we then decided... to do the joke at the end where Obama says the exact same things he said and it turns out to be about Tyler Perry. We put that in sort of the next day on Monday.
And the winner is... I think that might be it about FunnyBot.
Yep.
Let's All right, let's move on to the next one. So this is our royal pudding, which I remember when we started talking about this episode, Anne, I think... And maybe Susan, they were talking about... It was when the UK royal wedding was going on. And me, I was just like, I fucking hate that stuff. That's stupid. No one cares about that. You know what I mean? Like, I was like, our audience is going to... I mean, we had this big argument, remember? About, like, the royal wedding and, like, if that's a big enough subject. And I was like, that's fucking stupid. No one cares about that. And I was pretty wrong because it was, like, a big, you know... Everyone else was paying attention to it. But then that's where they just, like... I think it was making fun of that. The cadence of the way they talk about it. It was like, what if we do it in Canada?
Yeah, because like, the pieces I saw of it were that thing of like, of some narrator talking and going, you know, watching the whole thing and saying, well, this is the tradition, this is what we do here, and just like, well, this is all so weird. And so we decided to sort of combine the idea that no one cares, and of course, whenever we're talking about something no one cares about, we make it about Canada.
Yeah, but also what made it, so it was not, what I liked about it was like, wasn't about the UK, it wasn't about them. You know what I mean? Those them specifically. Yeah. We just made it in Canada.
But these I remember we did this whole bit right here first, just as sort of a sketch on Thursday, just to see if we thought it was going to work. And so it's kind of cool because it was sort of one of the scripts that's just like a sketch, really, that goes on a long time. And it worked so well as a sketch that then we had the idea of
bring it back in the end.
Yeah, and having
the conclusion.
Having Ike really care about it. And then when we added that, you know, what was the stakes because Ike was missing and we figured out the whole play and everything. So
yeah, because we had just done that. That was pretty much all we knew about at that time because we'd just done all the rehearsals for Book of Mormon.
It ended up being... And then we ended up with
And then we ended up with Tooth Decay.
Yeah. At the end. I don't know why.
Where I don't know.
I think that was we didn't know what else to do.
It's like Niagara Falls.
But it doesn't matter. That's the nice thing about being in Canada is it just doesn't matter.
And what did we get for... We got some really interesting like Native American speakers to do that.
Oh, yeah. We actually got...
I don't think
they were Eskimo.
They were from Canada, but they were Native American. We got them. They were in L.A. I think they were a different... one of the California tribes, and we had them, and they did that, the voice of that, which is so cool. It just had such a, like, a... That was one of the scenes, too. Remember, we had, like, a version where we did it, and it was, like, not funny. You wanted that real National Geographic feel to the voices to make it funny, to make it, like, legitimately, like, that's Canadian.
We actually had, like, two other scenes of Mackie screaming at the little kids, but they ended up getting cut, because It was too long.
He actually took them to Niagara Falls for some reason. I can't. He was going to take them to Niagara Falls because they were not being serious about like tooth decay.
Right.
And then that's how we were going to get them all together. Mm-hmm. But then we decided to bail on them.
They didn't need to be all together. All right, let's go to TMI. This is another episode that just started with a really simple little idea, which was I just had the idea of wanting Cartman to see that the school had published how much each student had grown in the past 6 months or whatever it was, and that he was going to think that it was about their penis sizes and be furious. And we started, and I was just like, I just thought that was funny, and then we're like, well, maybe it could be like an anger management show. And that could be that Callis is just that Cartman's really angry, but then it ended up being even more about penis sizes than anger management.
It was that thing of, I remember when I was growing up that, like, you know, people start talking about penis sizes, you have a big dick or like this or that or the other, and you have no idea. Like, you're 8 or you're 10 or you're 12 when all this shit comes up, and you just have no idea how you stack up against other guys. And, you know, our kids obviously are so young, this is where they learn to care about it, kind of, because before they really don't care. Like in this scene, only Cartman does.
Yeah.
But then Randy, and then we did the Randy, like there was anger management, and obviously, like, that is why guys get mad. But it isn't just because you have a small dick; it's because of the kind of horse race, or, you know, the sort of arms race, the way it's kind of presented. The kids get that way.
Yeah, because I remember we were talking too a lot about the whole BMI index thing and how, you know, because a lot of people think that that's not really the best way to figure, because it's always really bothered me, because according to the BMI, I'm obese, and I'm like, I mean, I'm not like athletic, but I wouldn't use the word obese. And I mean, according to the BMI too, I should weigh like 185 pounds, which is like what I weighed in high school, and I look like a total toothpick. Like, I don't really buy it. So that's why the whole TMI thing was just like all these weird numbers to get to your actual, and that it's all kind of just depends on whether you want it to look bigger or smaller.
Right, and who's making up the formula.
Yeah.
Yeah. We did a lot of BMI. We really worked on that equation for the TMI for a while to make sure it was copacetic. No shit, Sherlock.
I don't even remember anything else about this episode.
I remember Randy gets in a fight with that woman as soon as she comes in, and she's like, no, this isn't the official TMI. How's this episode end? I don't even remember.
We just did that song. We just did like a big, like, they decide to change.
Oh, right.
And then
right.
It's just like
everybody's happy.
Yeah, a song that everyone's happy. Because we tried to make that joke of just like everyone, obviously with a small penis, people in like rumors and shit.
Just tell guys they have big dicks and everyone think that the whole world would be better off.
I remember we came up with a lot of different ways to go with this show, but it all felt like that show, The List.
Yeah.
Everything we did, where we could never really have the girls in school really care about it. And it was just, I remember too, early on, we had that scene where he's in the principal's office. And this is, again, before we even knew what was going, but where he's pissed off at the principal saying, you know, she's like, why did you publish the boy's penis size? He's like, why did you? And it was just this cool scene that we sort of built the whole show around.
Yeah. It has a good beginning, this show.
Yeah. First act's real strong.
Cool. Well, on that, let's move on. 2.4 inches. Really nice,
Butters. This is our Crack Baby Athletic Association show, which was actually, I remember it was going to be the first show of the season, but we just didn't have enough. We didn't have the part figured out where Kyle was going to be kind of torn of whether to join or not. So there was nothing kind of emotional going on. Whereas, of course, Human Centipede, there was so much.
That's why we said to go with that.
But we just sort of had the idea before the season started. We just sort of had the idea about, you know, talking about the NCAA, but making it about crack babies instead.
Yeah, we had talked about making fun of the NCAA and the fact that they don't pay the players before. And then I remember, because I watched in like 1 week, I saw this Frontline did something on the NCAA, and then like Bryant Gumbel, Real Sports, did something. Like, it started to be that thing where it wasn't just, like, it's been one of those conversations that I've always had, like, at a bar, you know what I mean? Or just, like, one of those weird, like, 2 a.m. dorm room conversations, as people like to say. But then all of a sudden it was, like, felt like real journalists were, like, starting to be like, hey, wait a second, this is fucked up.
Maybe it was just right around March Madness.
Yeah, maybe it was just before March Madness. Maybe it was just me that I saw that, but it seemed to be, like, hey, you know, people are really starting to talk about this. And then the more we talked about it, yeah, we had a lot of the funny, like, crack baby jokes and the slavery jokes and stuff. But then it was really when we hit on that thing of making Kyle like the guy in the, is it The Firm?
No, Wall Street. Oh, we talked about the old
Wall Street. Yeah, Wall Street was a big one. And the Devil's Advocate, too, yeah. A little bit of that idea of, you know, how much of your morals are you going to, you know, how far can you, how can you look the other way when you're working for some immoral kind of organization? And yeah, it was the Charlie Sheen in Wall Street that we kind of model.
Yeah, we all had to go watch Wall Street that night. I remember.
And just how Kyle basically finds himself saying things to Stan, because we made Stan the foil that, like, Stan, Kyle, as he says something to Stan just has to look at him, and Kyle realizes, fuck, I sound exactly like Cartman. Or he says, you sound like Cartman right now, but Kyle just
I remember we took more and more, as it went on, we took more of Stan's lines out so that Stan actually never says anything back to him.
And Stan just sits there and looks at
him. Originally, it was these scenes
doesn't
of debate.
Doesn't he say you sound like Cartman right now?
I think he finally does, yeah. But it used to be that, I remember the scene was originally that Stan kept saying, wow, you sound like Cartman. And then Kyle would be like, oh, yeah, well, and it was just this normal kind of argument. Right. And then the more we took Stan's lines out and just had him staring at him, the more it became this kind of joke of an obvious argument that was going on. And
Kyle's arguing with himself, basically. Yeah. And Kyle is usually the one who is talking about the moral issues, so he doesn't really need – he just has to look at Stan. Just Stan just looks at him and he knows.
And I remember, too, we originally were trying to animate the crack babies actually playing basketball. And we were talking for, like, well, what are they going to actually do? Because they, you know, do they actually have a ball? Do they try to dribble? Yeah. You know, and we did these kind of tests and everything, and nothing was as funny as just as it would kind of be in the viewer's head. Yeah. So we decided to not even do that and let it all be hypothetical, and you kind of hear about it, but you never really get to see exactly. Sometimes in doing comedy, it's better to let people imagine what it would be. It's better.
You know, what was funny was it was around the time of this episode that, so Trey and I went to see you, and now see you wants to hit us up for money. We went to the University of Colorado, and like one of the reasons I really don't like college athletics, I'll be totally honest, is because I don't like college that much. So it just like doesn't even do athletics, doesn't like college. And we got this call that was like this was last year around the time this episode came out. The CU football coach, the Alumni Association called, I think, or something. Once he's going to be in LA doing some recruiting or something. He wants to stop by and say hi to you and Trey. Remember that?
Yeah.
And we were like, did you see the episode we did last week? Did you
watch? Well, and someone from CU called Butters, too, remember? And was like,
he wrote him
upset
an email.
About it? Yeah.
Yeah. Sort of upset and like, oh, you don't understand. Actually, the football actually doesn't make any money, you see, because we spend that money on other sports. It's like, but then you did make fucking money. You just spent it on other sports. Like,
we're not talking about what you're spending it on.
You can spend on whatever you want. You're making all the money, and the players are playing for free. So I'm really glad we did that slavery scene. I think that ended up really funny. And just like, without trying to explain it in some way, it's just like Cartman, of course, he just thinks that, you know, the NCAA has cracked this amazing business model, which, by the way, they have.
Yeah.
You know, so. All right, let's move on.
There's six hospitals within a 10-mile radius, and all we do is pit the crack babies against each other with a little ball of crack.
So this episode started as sort of a combination of two ideas. We kind of had, for a while, the idea of the difference between, like, basically, we used to have a friend named June who was our Japanese friend. And he really didn't like Chinese people very much, which was really funny to us. When, like, Japanese people are racist towards Chinese people and Chinese people are racist towards Korean and stuff like that, it's like, really makes us laugh.
Yeah, seeing racism in a from a point of view where you don't know anything, you're like, what, you guys hate each other? I mean, and they, you know, there are other people that look at us and Americans and do the same thing. I'm like, what? You know, like, or Slovakians hate Czechs and stuff like that. It's like, what? You know.
So we had the idea that, you know, that, for kicking around for a while, that a Japanese guy was going to open a restaurant right next to the City Walk guy so that we could have a Chinese guy and a Japanese guy going at it. And then we also had this idea where Butters is diagnosed with multiple personality disorder. And it really was, I think we started going on this episode and a few of the scenes before. It's one of those shows that it seems like at the end we'd kind of planned it out all along, that because it turns out that Butters' psychiatrist has multiple personality disorder, and he's actually the Chinese guy and has been all along. But we actually didn't think of that until like Saturday.
No, we didn't think about that till late.
And it was one of those big things where it's like, wow, we're taking like a, you know, not a huge character on South Park, but someone people know, and we're going to do this big thing. Like, is that okay? Like, we're going to make it. But it was
funny. I think it was too.
A lot of the Asians in our office were actually really happy.
Yeah,
a lot of
say.
The people that were, because like they had always kind of like, he is pretty much he's one of the worst like stereotypical characters we have. That's like,
yeah. What's your comment?
And to finally say like 10 years later, actually he's a white guy with multiple personalities.
Of course, it's a shitty accent, you know.
Yeah. And then we did act to them like all along. We were like, yeah, we knew that all along. Like we've just been waiting for the right time to do that. And they're like, oh, wow, it's really smart. We had this cool scene in this, too. It was like one of the first things we animated where Butters knew something was wrong with him, but he was hooked up his camera to see what it was. And the other boys had sort of like a paranormal idea, put like a security camera in his room. And the next day they're sitting there watching it, and Butters sleeping, and they see like visitors come in and check his ass, and they see crab people come in and go, and underpants gnomes, and they're all like, oh, nothing weird happened, that's just typical stuff. And it was a really funny scene, but it ended up not making the show, because it kind of, once the show took that direction of being more about his therapist, it didn't really fit anymore.
Yeah. And then we had the Psycho ending, which if you didn't know Psycho,
you'd be
fucking confused about that.
Yeah, that's kind of true. I'm afraid I have some bad news. But it was sort of going back and forth.
I think we had to go change this guy, too, after we came up with the idea. Didn't we have to change something so that he would look like...
Yeah, we actually had to make it so that it made sense that he was the Chinese
guy. Right
guy,
yeah.
And that is, yeah, that he, all he had to do was kind of squint and he could look like the Chinese guy.
He'd squint and comb his hair over the other way.
He seems to mostly jump in and
out. All right, let's move on. When he's outside playing.
This episode generated a lot more kind of interest than we meant it to. Like, this was the last episode of the run of the spring run, and we'd had the idea of Stan turning 10 and feeling like he's getting old, kind of, you know, as a reference to our getting older. And but like I had said before, this run actually was a pretty good one, and there's been other runs where at the end of it we felt like we really can't do this anymore, but at the end of, even during talking about this episode, we were already talking about how we could come back the next season and kind of answer some of the questions. But we did this episode, and then right afterwards was the Tony Awards, so we went out to New York, and suddenly we're getting interviewed by all the press, and they're like, so everyone's saying about the last episode, you know, it seems like you guys are done, is that it, is South Park over? And we were like, no, you know, but looking back at it, it kind of does look like we're kind of saying we don't want to do this anymore, but it's not really what we were saying.
Yeah, I mean, it's like there's so much in the episode that's so obviously, I can see why people thought. I mean, it's kind of so obviously us, and, you know, parts of it, or there seems to be a comment within it.
And the big thing, and obviously we did do it consciously, was like, let's do Leave It Hanging. Let's do have...
Right.
Stan's parents said, like, South Park's all about kind of resetting at the end so that the next week we can do whatever we want again. And we're like, let's not do it. Let's have it end more like, a lot of the dramas do now, where it's just like shit goes bad and shit just goes bad. And then we really didn't know by the end of this. And in fact, we didn't know until the next season started, like, how we were going to get out of it, and were we going to leave them separated, and how we were going to answer everything. But I think a lot of... The more I talk to people out here, the more I realize everyone does that in this business. Like, they'll just leave it whatever sounds best, and then they'll all get together and figure out how to go from there.
Yeah, totally. We thought that people were more responsible than us, but they're not. They're kind of the same thing. I mean, one thing we talked about a lot with this episode was that, you know, South Park basically is a movie structure in some ways, but it's very sitcom or television show in other ways, where we don't serialize things. It's just the end of this show. The whole, you know, everything goes back to normal. We start next week. And Stan's, that's the whole thing of, like, this is just the same shit over and over. And what Sharon says in the end, it's sort of like the form of the show being one where everything's going to be okay in the end and it's going to reset, is sort of like an immature view of the world. And I think that's why, like, some of these cool new shows that are serialized, why that's been so popular lately, is because it's like it's a really cool form to just say, well, the world doesn't work that way. And so Stan gets this big lesson in the end. And I think for a viewer, you know, if you watch South Park and you're used to this happening at the end, all of a sudden that form breaks and the world doesn't kind of go back to the, you know, it's not going to have a happy ending this week.
I think there were just a lot of people that really thought it was, that we were saying, like, we might come back for a season, but that's about it. And all the articles that came out was like, does this mean the end of South Park? And
awesome.
We were like, no, but
I can see why. But looking back, I can see why. Even though we kind of didn't mean it that way, it's because we were commenting on the actual form of the show.
The show honestly started just as this joke. We just had the joke of
Tween Wave,
and this music that literally was just shitting. And at first, it was going to be that's really what it was, and people thought it was good. But then we're like, oh, what if it only sounds that way to adult? And it's kind of like Emperor's New Clothes. And that's really where the thing was. And then what's funny is that whole argument that happens between Stan's parents at the end was like written on Tuesday morning. Like it was one of the last things put in.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole show, you know, this big thing that everyone thought was this big reason for the show actually was kind of an afterthought in a little bit. And we were hoping, I think by Sunday we started cutting things together with that Stevie Nicks song Landslide at the end. And we were just praying and praying we would get that song. I remember we got it like Tuesday night. Like we barely got that song.
Yeah.
And we had some backups and none of it worked as well. But, it was a cool ending for us, but we were definitely like...
We just also couldn't think of a great ending, too. Yeah. I mean, that's part of it is like we'd set up this kind of existential crisis for Stan, and it didn't feel like you could just shit, you know, just like out of it. Because we were kind of talking about that very thing. So then to do it felt like a kind of a crap out. To keep using the pun, yeah. but once we put in Landslide and saw it, we're just like, this is cool, and I don't really know what, you know what I mean? We didn't really think too much about like what it was saying on a bigger level. It just felt really satisfying, like a real end to, you know, real good emotional end to the show.
Yeah. but it had our favorite. This episode actually has, I think Matt and I agreed, our favorite thing of any South Park ever, which is Duck President.
I forgot about Duck President.
And I think it was one of those
things. When we came back, I was like, I don't give a shit what we say about Stan. We just have to have Duck President.
Yeah. I just remember that every time in the retake when Duck President was on shitting, quacking and shitting, we just thought it was the greatest thing ever.
But you know what we were totally wrong about was Jack and Jill came out and it was really good.
Yeah. We were ripping on it. This is well before. This was like.
This is when the trailer came out.
6 months before Jack and Jill came out. And we're like, it looks like it's not going to be a good movie. But man, it came out and just hit it out of the park.
Boy,
what a great piece of cinema that
boy,
was.
Boy, were we wrong.
All right, let's go to part two.
Jack and Jill.
So we had the summer off from South Park, and then we came back basically in the room going, okay, now what the hell do we do? And how are we going to answer all of this stuff? You know, do we leave them divorced? Do we... some of the ideas were that we were going to just keep going like this. Stan lives in an apartment with his mom, and we were just going to have the show go on like that. But, you know, almost immediately we're like, really, we're not going to have Randy around? And Randy's such a great character in the show. And, you know, the more we talked about these big things of, you know, people really liked that we took this big change, you know, this big right turn with the show, and like, how can we keep doing that? And we came up with all these different ideas of how to keep it like this. And
we're going to do a serialized thing.
Yeah, do a serialized thing where he slowly, through the course of the season, tried to get his parents back together. But, like, every time we talked about it, we'd kind of run into a wall and just go, God, you know, it's like we're having to focus on the drama of it all and not be able to just do what's the funniest thing, which is how we do the show. And finally we're like, you know what? This is South Park. It's a cartoon. People, you know... It's tuned in for that reason. Like it's, you know, we finally were like, you know, we're just kind of stuck. We just don't really have a choice. Things are going to have to just reset, as much as, you know, maybe people will hate that we finally didn't reset. And now we're just going to come back and reset at the end. And we're like, well, maybe we should reset, but just make that really sad. The fact that right. We have to reset.
I remember Vernon was the one that said, oh, what if we play Landslide again and do that? That
yeah,
it was just, like that kind of key. Cause I really hated the idea of just not doing, like really just crapping out on it. I felt like people had some real emotional connection to that last show, and we want to do something kind of satisfying, but like Trey said, we didn't want to like really go, it's like,
and just make it a sad show
and make it a sad show and like all emotionally complex and shit for, you know, I don't think people would want that. I don't know if we'd be good at that.
And we knew we had these first few scenes, we really liked this, where all the typical South Park stuff was happening but Stan was just standing there. We really liked all that stuff. We had that for a while. And we had talked about the whole sort of Matrix drinking thing, which was a big, big step to take, have Stan to become an alcoholic.
Just become an alcoholic. But then at least he goes and gets to see Jack and Jill and he really likes it.
Yeah, because he's drunk.
Because basically he's drunk. So he can handle the shittiness of the world if he gets drunk. But then that's not going to work either. I remember the big moment. I remember where I felt like, okay, I think we earned our way back. Was when we came the idea of Stan growing up in a real way, because I think it's a real, you know, growing up process to finally say, you know what, my parents are divorced and it's not going back. The world's not going to go back to the way it was. That's the way kids think. It's like, I just want to wake up in the same bed every day and have the same great day and do this thing. And then you get to be a certain age and it's like bad shit starts happening and you don't get to go back. You know, that's a real, really deep thought. And Stan finally gets it. And he gets it in this way that's like, you know what, life isn't like a fucking stupid sitcom where you have to learn some lesson, then everything snaps back. And then at that moment, everything snaps back.
Right.
And I feel like that was, I was like, okay, that's cool. That feels like we earned our way back. You know, within what we had kind of set up last season, but it was hard to come. I remember it was hard to make all of this sort of line up.
Well, because we had a lot. We also had all the Asperger's stuff going on, which we had talked about for a while too, doing a show about Asperger's. But in the years before, like, that word wasn't used as much, so we were just worried, like, well, if we do a show about Asperger's, everyone's gonna think we're making that name up. Mm-hmm. But finally, Asperger's had made it enough into the popular culture that we could do a show about how unfortunate of a name that disease is.
We always love that thing too. If we left the show, people are like, wow, they're really sick of doing, you know, South Park now. Book of Mormon is kind of a big hit, and maybe they're sick of doing South Park. And then we won the Tonys in the off period, right?
Yeah.
And then we just thought it was super funny to then just basically almost answer the question in the title of the show of like, nope, Asperger's.
Yep.
They're just doing that fucking shit. It's still like
Carmen's got hamburgers in his pants.
That's it. That's what we're doing. So, but I remember being done with the show and feeling like, okay, good, we got out of that
one. We got out of it. Now we can go back to just making South Park.
Yeah.
Let's move on. This is probably my favorite show of this whole season.
I think me too. I like this episode a lot.
This just came out of the idea. Really, the first idea was like, let's just have the kids playing a game of Mexicans versus Texans or versus Border Patrol. And then we started watching some of those Border Patrol shows that are on now.
God damn it. And then it's like, yeah, watching any show that like makes cops and stuff look cool, like I get really bummed out on. Not because I don't like cops, but because it's just the cops working together with TV producers, working together with advertisers doesn't seem like a good trinity.
Yeah.
It's just always, and we've done a couple of shows that kind of make fun of that trinity, but there's Border Wars, right?
Yeah.
There's another one. There's DEA, which is kind of similar. And then we also were talking about immigration, and I read this thing about how immigration is actually a decade low right now, immigration from Mexico, that because of a ton of really, you know, serious reasons, there's like a lot less immigration right now. And then at the same time, you have these shows. It's like immigration's a big problem, and it's completely at odds with the reality. So I mean, that's how we started talking about the Mexicans going back. That became kind of that scene where the Border Patrol agent are watching the wrong way.
Yeah.
And then they get confused about what the hell they're supposed to do.
And then when we thought that Butters was going to keep playing the game and just be a little Mexican, and we saw that, we're like, oh, what's Butter in Spanish? And it's, when we saw it was Montequillo, we're like, oh, that's perfect.
Yeah, because Butters has like, Butters is like a little like, hey, Butter, like a little cute name. But Montequillo sounds like kind of noble. You know, it sounds like Montezuma or something. It sounds like a big noble guy.
Yeah, this was, we had this whole first, this is another one where we just sort of, it's nice when we have the whole first scene done. Like, this was the first thing we wrote on Thursday, was this whole thing where they're playing the game, and we didn't quite know where it was going to go yet, but it's always good when you have a lot of times we just have middle scenes and we have no idea how we're going to get in it or get out of it. This was nice to at least know where we were starting from.
Yeah, the hard part about this episode, I remember we were working on animating that last, the chase scene between, we knew, like, the idea that is somehow is going to boil down to Cartman trying to keep Butters from crossing the real border. Seemed like where we wanted to end the show.
Yeah.
But actually making that a satisfying chase was kind of a big pain in the ass to do. I remember that was like the last thing we did.
Yeah, because this was a show, I remember that this was one of those shows that was like, everyone was laughing a lot the whole week as every scene came in. So, but sometimes those are the more stressful ones because then it's like, all I think is, okay, all I can do now is ruin it. So it's like, so sometimes the ones that are getting the biggest laughs are the most stressful. Like, I remember this part with Butters. It was like, originally, I don't know why, we had never even thought of the fact that he gets lost. He was just couldn't get over the border for some reason. So he was actually right outside the fence, outside of Cartman's. And then, of course, you know, that sounded fine. But then as soon as we watched it, and we're like, well, why can't he get over that little fence? It made no sense. And our brains were just so locked into one way that it wasn't until Sunday we're like, oh, he's just lost. He just doesn't know where he is. And I don't know why we didn't think about it sooner.
Maybe it's looking at this awesome snow. Yeah. Finally convinced us, hey, you could have got awesome
snow. Our snow has gotten a lot better.
Look at that snow.
The snow's all really computer generated.
That looks like real snow right there.
And this work Mexican work song is a little song I wrote like 6 years ago. I think I was in Hawaii. And I was playing some little like xylophone thing that only, and for some reason this little tune came to my head. I never thought it would end up in South Park, but it did.
In work Mexican work.
Yeah. All right,
let's move on.
I have to get across the border. Mis amigos.
This episode is, again, a sort of a merging of a bunch of little ideas. Originally, at the start of the season, we just had this idea that a kid was going to crap his pants and Cartman was going to be asked to not fan the flames as he had done before. And so, actually, the first few scenes of him in with the principal and Mr. Mackey were there, saying that this kid had done this and we want you to help us, you know, make it because the last kid had killed himself and all that. We'd actually had that as an idea for a show a while ago. And we thought where it was going to go was that it was going to be this thing where Cartman was going to actually try to help this kid and how he was going to try to divert all the tension and make it so that this kid didn't kill himself. And then it just ended up becoming about a whole lot more. It really was a whole TMZ thing, and then WikiLeaks with the phone hacking, and then as soon as we said the word WikiLeaks, for some reason, LemmyLinks came to mind. And
yeah, it was like WikiLeaks is such a weird name anyway, and then it reminded us of LemmyLinks, and we came up with Bass-to-Mouth and Ass-to-Trout, and then we knew that we had to do that.
There used to be a lot more of that in this show, and it all got cut out because it's way funnier in the room than it was on the screen. But it was also too, for a long time we'd been figuring out how to bring LemmyLinks back, and then we had the idea of his evil brother, WikiLeaks.
That's really all we had. And we tried to spin it into a whole episode.
I just remember this one was tough because we kept going in all these different directions. And then it's sort of one of those that, this is one of those shows that easily could have been two different episodes.
Yeah.
Because there was so much just with them approaching Cartman and trying to get him to.
I mean, there's a little bit about, you know, Cartman saying, you know, you don't understand the way the world works. It's kind of like with technology now and everybody wanting to appear in everyone's messages and stuff. There's no such thing as, you know, like secrecy or, you know. And that was kind of where we talked about, like, the commonality between WikiLeaks and the phone hacking thing and TMZ is just this, like, wanting to get into other people's shit. And, like, in England, when it finally was, like, that girl who got murdered, then everyone got pissed off. But it was, like, before that, everyone was stoked on it.
Yeah.
You know, so we kind of talked about that, too, that how hard it is for the kids to resist until it's about them. And then we had a little gerbil with a microphone on his head. That was about, that's about how smart it got. Very serious episode.
Yeah, and I remember we had to get, when we knew there was going to come to a fight between WikiLeaks and LemmyLinks, and it was one of those, again, where we found video footage of two squirrels fighting, and they just animated that, because the way squirrels fight are really funny, and the way that they'll stand up and kind of chirp at each other. And so for the longest time in the cut, we just had this real video footage of two squirrels fighting while they sat there and kind of painstakingly rotoscoped the whole thing.
Yeah, we rotoscoped it and then worked on it, yeah. Maybe it should have been two episodes, this one.
Yeah, we always regret that, because then we, of course, you know, the following weeks, we run out of ideas and we're like, boy, we wish we would have made that two episodes. All right. Turn public opinion
around. You're crazy! I mean, look, guys, I know it was just the Dolphins.
So after we had done Book of Mormon, which we did with our friend Bobby Lopez, it was really fun working with Bobby, and he's a really funny guy. So at some point during that whole thing, we're like, you know, you should come one week and do an episode of South Park with us and just, you know, be in the room and kick around ideas. We really didn't, when he arrived on Thursday, we got in the room and we kicked around a whole, it was also Halloween time. So we're like, well, we could just do a Halloween show. We didn't necessarily think we were going to do anything about Broadway or musicals until we kind of had this idea that maybe, you know, what if we like blatantly do the thing that's like trying to make Broadway cool for dudes and that it's all about bros and everything. And, you know, it's always scary when you go into a show like this and you've got to write a bunch of songs, because even though they're short, it's still a bunch of songs you got to write. So,
and then I remember you wrote that song for the middle with the Tim Tebow song.
Yeah, and that's what I'm most proud of, because
Tim Tebow song.
We actually, if you look at when this aired, it was actually October 26th of 2011, which was before Tebow Mania started at all. It was the first week he started playing, and I wrote all these Tim Tebow songs, just sort of predicting all that, and then Tebow Mania really happened.
I think you started Tim Tebow Mania.
I think I did. But yeah, we wrote the songs.
Then Bro Down and Broadway. That's kind of when the Bro Down is the best part of the show. The Stephen Sondheim and stuff, and they come in the Hooters and do the Bro Down. It's like, bro, that's really like funniest.
But I remember I kept putting it off, and like we'd written a couple of the songs for like the Wicked parodies, but there were all these other songs like the montage when Randy's in New York, and then we needed other songs for Randy's musical and everything, and Bobby kept saying like, when are we going to write those? And I'm like, we'll worry about that later because we were just trying to figure out the story. And then it got to be like Tuesday, and Bobby's like, when are we going to write those songs? And I was like, I guess we should write those now. And we were just like frantically writing songs on Tuesday. And we got it all done.
Yeah. I wish Bobby could just move to L.A. and just work on South Park all the time. It'd be great. It'd be fun working with him. But unfortunately, he has a life and a big career and everything. But he's like, that was such a cool thing to have him come out. Maybe we can get him to do it again.
Yeah, probably.
We don't have to do a musical episode.
No,
do
we're gonna.
You know? All right, let's move on. That's Blowjobs and me.
So this is the show we did because all these 99%er rallies were happening all over the country. And
we thought we'd say something really smart about it.
Yeah.
So here it was.
We had had the idea before about Cartman. It was actually going to be that he was going to have a heart attack at school because his health was so bad. But then we, with the 99% rallies, we thought, oh no, it'll be good that he's, you know, his health is so bad that it kind of affects everybody else.
Right. He's, yeah.
But it also came from...
He's throwing a curve.
The big thing that happened was there was a scene in episode 201 where we were kind of bringing back a lot of old things from South Park. There was a big scene where, because in that episode we had brought back Mitch Connor and Jennifer Lopez on Cartman's hand. And we had this big scene in that where Cartman was sitting at the table having tea with all his stuffed animals again, because that was another big callback. And he was telling his mother to sit down because he wanted to talk about who his father was again. And anyway, it ended up being this big scene that was cool, but we had to cut out of that entire show because we just didn't have time for it. And it wasn't totally necessary. So we had always kind of saved that scene in our back pocket of like, that's a cool scene. If we ever want to revisit the sort of stuffed animals and the tea parties, maybe we can find another reason to do it. And so we had kind of had this other idea rolling around where at some point Cartman knows he's got to get rid of his stuffed animals, but he's got to do it in Cartman's way, which is to slowly, you know, have it be all about murder and who killed who and everything and finally shoot one of them and kill her. And so it was sort of a good... Pretty quickly, we thought, oh, we could marry this whole idea of the 1% or 99% with this old idea we had of Cartman with his stuffed animals, and that's how it all kind of
came. Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to be Cartman just kind of needs to grow up. It's like, dude, you need to grow up. It's like, and his whole thing of like, oh, I'm the 1%, I'm fat. It's like, you need to start eating better. You need to get rid of your stuffed animals was this whole thing. And of course, Cartman can't just do that. He has to create a whole drama to make it happen. And I don't really remember. I mean, we tried to make fun of the 1% stuff. It just wasn't that funny. You know, we tried to do a little bit more of that. But the stuff with Cartman ended up being much, you know, watching Cartman's whole internal dialogue happen.
Yeah.
Just seemed to be much better.
Well, just to know that he'll even go to these extremes and fuck around, even when there's no one's benefit. But it's like, even just to convince himself, you know, it's like he can't possibly... just listen to everyone and say, oh, maybe I should grow up.
Yeah, no, he's truly nuts. Remember, we had to figure out when Kyle breaks in and Stan breaks into Token's house in the end, we had to figure out, okay, we have to make sure there's actually time for Cartman to go run and put that whole setup in the end and make sure that it does sort of make sense what Cartman, you know, does in the end.
And so we had all of his old stuffed animals, but then we also decided to put in a Marc Jacobs stuffed animal because we had seen this thing about a year ago. We'd seen a picture in a magazine of Marc Jacobs, and we saw that he actually had a tattoo of Clyde Frog and Rumpelstiltskin.
Yeah.
And we're like, and someone pointed it out to us and said, look, Marc Jacobs has these tattooed on. We're like, wow, that's pretty sweet.
That guy's fucking dedicated.
So we thought, like, let's just do a little homage to that, and we'll have Cartman now have a little Marc Jacobs doll. And as you can see, the Marc Jacobs doll actually has little tattoos of Clyde Frog and Rupert Dumpskin on him. So it's kind of funny. But then, apparently, Marc Jacobs saw this episode, did this interview where he said, like, it was the greatest honor of his life.
Oh, he sent us a nice little card. He sent us a nice little card saying how honored he was.
And then he went and got a tattoo of the Marc Jacobs doll on him, which is sweet because he's got now, Marc Jacobs has a tattoo of Marc Jacobs, which has a tattoo of Clyde Frog and Rumper Tubskin on him.
That makes me like Marc Jacobs.
That's why he's a designer. Like, we wouldn't have thought of that.
That's really smart.
All right.
Let's move on.
What are you guys talking about?
So this episode was our Thanksgiving special, and it came out on November 9th. And a lot of people asked us, why did we do our Thanksgiving special 3 weeks before Thanksgiving and not the last episode of the season? And the answer, it's two reasons. One, because we couldn't think of anything else that week. We had this idea. This was one of the first ideas we had when we got together at the beginning of the season. We're like, okay, good, we have our last episode figured out, which will be a Thanksgiving special. But then we got to this week, and we just couldn't think of any other shows. We're like, well, we could do the Thanksgiving special. And then we kind of fooled ourselves into thinking, we'll do the Thanksgiving special. Let's get going. And we'll make it two parts.
Yep.
And that way, it makes sense that we're doing it now.
Yeah.
But then, of course, by Monday, we got into it and we're like, this is never going to be two parts. So it's just going to be a Thanksgiving special, and then there'll be some other random show. But we think about that stuff too much, too. It just probably didn't really matter that much. But
didn't matter to me in the end. We thought it would matter. And then we thought, oh, we'll do a Christmas special. That's why we had to do a Thanksgiving special. It's just making things worse. So then we decided, fuck it. Let's just leave it. No one's going to care. And really, no one does care.
But it kind of came from two things. One being Thor, because I saw Thor on DVD, and I actually kind of liked it. I thought it was cool. And then also the stuff we've been talking about a long time, which was History Channel and the way that they have all these shows on History Channel that have nothing to do with history. And in fact, they have all these shows about UFOs and like monsters and stuff and ghosts. And it's just like by putting it on something called History Channel, I think you're really...
Ancient Aliens is just pretty brutal.
That's the worst.
I mean, this little parody right here of like Thanksgiving is really... 1% more, like, it adds 1% of satire on top of what Ancient Aliens already pretty much is.
Yeah.
So, it was just kind of like this. When we started talking about it, it was like that idea when you come, you go, you know what, Thor, and then Thor the movie sort of is like Ancient Aliens, right? I mean, the whole idea is like, well, ancient, there's this advanced civilization a long time ago that came from space and the Earth, but at least it's a fucking movie based on a comic book. It's not called the History Channel. So when we put those two together, I really like Thor too. I actually watched it because we're going to do this episode. But I guess that's, I mean, it was that. And then what was our other big?
Well, it was one of those.
Once we came up with the idea of like, there's also we kind of did a little bit in this in the end, but there's this thing that's happening in like, I guess it's kind of like steampunk aesthetic, but like there's this thing happening in big movies where it's like Three Musketeers and Sherlock Holmes, where it's kind of like 200 years ago and stuff, but it should be like, it's like everything's fucking sweet, you know, in the 1800s and stuff. So that's, we talked about like the, with the final battle and stuff, that was, these ships that were, way too fucking sweet.
Yeah. And it was luckily, since we did have the idea at the beginning of the season, we were able to get everyone modeling all of this stuff. Because that's always a problem when we have a big idea like this where there's all this crazy intergalactic battles. It's like, how do we get everything drawn in time for the show? And so we actually cut this together. We actually did a joke out of it where we made a trailer for Pilgrims versus Indian, sort of a Thor-like trailer. And we almost, for a minute, we were going to put that in the episode Asperger's as another kind of like, coming June 16th, fuck you, like as a joke, and then actually do the show at the end of the season. And we ended up not doing that, but it helped us because we were able to have the artist draw all the different pilgrims and the ships and all that stuff. And so we had a bit of a jump on it, which was very necessary.
Maybe we should have done two. I think this episode turned out pretty good.
Yeah.
And Natalie Portman. And she's the wormhole.
Yeah, and it just becomes a big rip on Natalie.
For no reason.
For no reason. All right.
One more.
See what I mean, you guys?
So now we're at the last show of the season, and we were definitely running a little low on ideas, but then luckily for us, the whole Penn State thing happened. And so we got to the... Sometimes, when we're trying to think of ideas, we'll just say, let's just try to do a show centering around this character. And we hadn't done anything around Kenny for such a long time that I remember we, this whole discussion started as like, what can we do with Kenny and kind of make it about him? And we had had the idea before that he gets sent to a foster home. And so that we started just kicking around that whole thing.
Yeah, that's where it started, was what if he gets sent to a foster home? And then we went through like the normal, like, it took us a while to get like, what's the joke of the foster home? Because the thing about like, oh, there's this, you know, mechanized, industrialized thing where they try to adopt kids to make money. It's like, I don't know, it seemed like it had been done before or whatever. And then,
or that he goes to a rich home, that seems so dumb.
Yeah, so then we came up with the idea of like, well, a lot of foster homes are pretty religious people who, you know, for religious reasons find it that that's kind of why they want to adopt a bunch of kids and stuff. Then we came up upon the idea of the militant agnostics, and that seemed like there was something to go on. And that stuff ended up being really funny. And it ended up going on with Mysterion and being like, at least in the end, when they're going looking around for him, like Mysterion can leave a question mark and it freaks him out and stuff. So, but really, I mean, it was really lucky that the Penn State thing happened at this time, because that gave us some real fuel.
Well, and we always, and
this was about a week after that, right?
Yeah,
it was like the week after.
It was right around that.
There were people who said too soon, and they were probably right, but it sure was funny.
But we also, I remember that part of the idea was, you know, we've seen Kenny's brother and sister a lot of times in the show, and we never even named them, really. I think we had to go back to like season four to see one time their names had been mentioned to see what they were. And so we were just like, can we get into their characters at all? And then we ended up not really getting so much into their characters, but we just thought it was a cool thing that Kenny had to be kind of Mysterion for his little sister. And then we have my...
Well, this is a way where Kenny can talk, too. Yeah. Makes him...
Our friend Chris Borkovec, who's a cop, he's the person we go to when we need to talk about these kind of things. He told us about this room, which is... Wasn't it called the safe room?
Soft room. Yeah.
Which
it's
is
what a kid is, yeah.
Yeah, in police departments. He's like, they have a soft room where kids in this situation are you know, put in, and they usually have, like, they try to make it feel a little kid-like and happy. And so that's when we came up with the idea for this scene. And he ends up, Chris did some voices in the show, too. But all in all, we were... pretty glad that we got this whole season behind, because we knew it was going to be a rough one having to do Book of Mormon and two seasons at the same time in the same year. And so when we got this one behind us, we were pretty happy.
Come on now, how
about that smile? But then we found out after doing this that we'd have to wait like a month and a half, almost 2 months, to be able to do this commentary. We were really sad.
It's fucked up my whole holidays.
And,
I can't think about anything.
We couldn't really have a good Christmas or a good New Year's.
I haven't been able to think about anything.
I remember I called Matt on Christmas and was like, do you think we could do the commentary now? Is there any way? And they were just like, no, you got to wait a few more weeks.
We wanted to do it on Christmas Day, but the crew, you know, we had to give them off and stuff, but it's been tough. It's been tough.
But with all that being said, for all of you listening, thanks so much.
Do we only do this once a year? Doesn't it seem like we do this like,
it seems like we do this
fucking every 2 weeks? It's like, God damn it.
And we love it so much.
But I'll see you next year.
Thanks so much, and we'll make some more. Bye. Who's the poorest kid in school now? Pretty much went through everybody. Craig's got the most... Here he comes.